cool, but I just think, you know, that's what I would do. Whoa, all right. So he brings them down. They have this amazing ceremony. I mean, I could just see that truly is God's first covenant of saying, this is your wife created specifically for you because you had a need that you couldn't find in having a goldfish in a bowl. You couldn't find in having a pet gorilla. That need was just not fulfilled. He needed the woman. He needed Eve to fulfill it. Men, if you are married or if you feel something inside of you that says that I want to get married one day, you have that from God saying, yes, you need a companion. You need a helpmate. You need somebody there to be by your side. Remember those words that you said, for better, for worse, in sickness and in health? Most of us, when we're saying those, we just mean for better. And we just mean when you're healthy. But we have to take all of it to account. Because marriage does get worse, right? Remember I said there were little micro lessons in all of these. So this is my sermon on this, and then we'll close this up, and then we'll go into other things. So right now it's on the marriage. Marriages do get bad at times, right? But they're good too. They are good. Marriages are good. Sometimes we do get sick. You made that vow in front of God. I don't care if you did it at a courthouse. God made marriage, okay? It doesn't matter what the government says. God made marriage. He made marriage between a man and a woman, okay? It doesn't go on to say that he also created Steve. And that he also created, no, it doesn't say that, okay? Just, and if we were in Canada, I'd be going to jail right now, so. And that might be coming to the United States at some point in time very soon. God created marriage for man and for woman, and he blessed it. And what did he tell him to do? Be fruitful and multiply. That's what he told him to do. All right, awesome. You guys are doing great. Now, men, God also wants us to be men. We need to be men, real men. Genesis chapter 2. This is God speaking only to Adam. Eve was not created yet. Okay? The verse that we just read was before this, right? You guys remember what that was? Genesis chapter 2, 19 through 22 was what we just read. So 16 through 17 on the number line would be before that, right? So this happened before Eve was created. The Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat of it, you will surely die. God calls the man out here and says, I'm going to tell you this. Now this is very relevant because we're going to jump into chapter 3 and we're going to see what happens. But God is telling man to do this. Men, you need to step up. We need to be real men. Because if we jump forward here, Genesis chapter 3. The serpent is now talking to Eve. Eve has been created. The serpent says, did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, we may eat from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die. So you understand that Eve now knew that. So at some point in time, Adam had to tell Eve that we weren't allowed to eat this tree. Okay? Adam communicated that. He was some kind of leader at one point in time. Men, are you leading your house at all? Are you listening to God for any kind of example to be communicated to the rest of your house? Women, you need to listen to your husbands. I know I just took your foot and went. But it truly is biblical. The Bible talks about submission. That doesn't mean that you're his slave. Husband, that doesn't mean that your wife is your slave. That's not what it is at all. She is your helpmate. I've given this example before. You've got two lieutenants that are messing around with some privates. Okay? They're messing around with army privates. And so all of a sudden, the commander walks by and he sees those two lieutenants. He's not too happy with it. So he calls them over and he says, all right, I've got a list of 30 things that I want you both to do. But he looks to one of them and he says, you need to come back and you need to tell me that it's done. So they go out and they start doing this thing. Well, the lieutenant that got called out, he's telling the other one, hey, you go and do this and I'll do this. You go and finish that and then I'll get this done. Well, the problem is that they're the same rank. And so the other lieutenant said, well, who put you in charge? And he said, the commander, when he pointed at me and said, you need to come back and tell me when it's done, that's when I got put in charge. I have to go back and give an account for what we've done. Guess what, husbands? You're that lieutenant. God is saying, yes, you both are equal, but you need to come back and say when the job's done and that it's done right. Men, that is our job. It's not a fun one, but that is our job, and we need to embrace it. The bottom line, that comes down to having a relationship with God. If you do not, you will never be a man. You just won't be. The world might say, yeah, you're a wonderful man, but to God, you're not the man that he wants you to be. I know, stepping on toes all over the place. Yes? Anybody uncomfortable right now? Oh, man. All right. Now, I want to go into something just a little bit. All right, we're going to close the door on marriage, okay? We just closed it. That doesn't mean that we don't open it up at some point in time. But God, really, I mean, we need to take that serious. Marriage is serious. God truly has blessed it. So let's be obedient to him. All right, one time I was inside of a gymnasium, and I was watching a graduation. Everything was going fine. Everything was wonderful. We were about halfway through the graduation. The person sitting beside me goes, do you hear the lights? And me, being as sarcastic as I am, I'm like, well, I never knew that light put off a sound. So, yeah, I'll listen. This is amazing. Well, have you ever been in a gym where the lights go, all the time? That is what they do all the time. That's what kind of gym we were in. And so, you know, OCD me, the only thing that I can hear now is me the whole time. You see, I was fine until my focus was put onto the lights, until I realized that that's what they were doing. You following me? Think about that. All right, so now we're going to jump into Genesis chapter 3, verse 6. So the serpent has had this conversation with Eve. Is the fruit really that bad? See, the first thing it says, that when the woman saw that the fruit was good for food and pleasing to the eye, you see, when she finally noticed it, when her focus had been taken off of God and when she really looked at it, her OCD kicked in, and that's all she could think about. Oh, man, that fruit does really look good. And it really, it's amazing. It's a beautiful fruit. Man, it'd be so good to eat it. And then it's going to give me wisdom. Her focus was drawn to it. And then inevitably, what happened? She took it and she ate it. This is the biggest downfall in humanity. And we've only got two people on the earth. Of course, the world's going to be messed up now. We got quite a few more than two people. But right here is where sin got introduced into our world. Everything was great, perfect, wonderful. It would go on to say that women, you would have went through childbirth with no pain if Eve hadn't have eaten the fruit. Wouldn't that be great? How many women have a conversation with Eve? Yeah. Men, there would have been no distinction within our marriage. There would have been nothing that went between husband and wife. Marriages would have been great. We could have worked the ground and we wouldn't have to till it. We wouldn't have had to work at it. It just would have grew whatever we needed. That would have been awesome, right? It would have been great. But no, her focus was taken off of what God had said, and it was put on to, oh, how pleasing that sin was. Man, it looked so good. How much in your life is your focus taken off of God and putting on to how good the sin looks? Your focus is taken off of what you know that God wants you to do, and Satan's over there looking like, oh, look how good that is. And that would feel good, that would taste good, that would be great. Other people would think you were amazing if you had it. He's trying to take our focus off of what God is telling us to do. And then what's manly Adam do? He just stands there. He was right beside Eve. God had said, do not eat this fruit. That's it. You can have everything else just right here. Don't eat it. And Adam's just standing there while a snake is talking to his wife. Duh. I mean, I know some weird people talk to my wife. Some of them are in this room. But if a snake would start talking to her, I'd probably have a little issue with that. But he just stood there. while she picked it off, whatever it was. We put up an apple or something like that. We don't know what it was. It could have been a banana. But she took it and she ate it. And he was standing there watching the whole time. Because then the Bible goes on to say that she took it and handed it to him. And dummy Adam went, that's good. Yes, I know if mama ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. But at some point in time, the man of God has to step in and go, no, God said we don't do this. So guess what? We don't do it. Husbands, stand up and be the man that God is calling you to be. And women, listen to them. If you have a godly husband, please listen to them. Please be their cheerleader, not their critic. Please be all for them, not all against them. And husbands, quit being Gumby and start being a hero. Right? Your wife wants a hero. Not that you have to look buff, but she wants somebody that she can just look to and know that it is going to be okay. That when the world is going crazy, she finds strength in us. She just knows that it's going to be all right. Satan is trying to take your focus off of what God said. What God is telling you to do. Don't let him. You can never stop Satan from whispering in your ear, but you can choose not to listen. You can choose not to listen. You're given that power by the blood of Jesus, by the Holy Spirit. And I just jump forward a few thousand years. All right, I know we're getting to it. I know I'm losing a lot of you. Let's jump into Noah here, okay? Because now we've had sin. Adam and Eve are kicked out of Eden. They're not allowed to go back in. They have two boys called Cain and Abel. What happens? Anybody know what happened with Cain and Abel? Cain killed Abel. If there was no sin in the world, guess what? They would have liked each other. They wouldn't have killed each other. Parents, some of the things that we do has a direct impact on our children. It has a direct impact. Now, that doesn't mean just because of my sin, now my child is going to have something wrong with them. All right, God cleared that up with David. But what he said is that there is an impact from your sin into your children's. If you guys would choose not to follow God, guess what? You've pretty much given your child no hope of following God. Because this world's not going to give it to them. So we've got into Cain and Abel, and now we're actually getting to the point that God is really sorry that he ever created us. Genesis chapter 6. I give out to you, Eric. No. Sorry. Okay. Well, I just went through that, so that's all right. Genesis chapter 6, verse 5 through 6 says this. The Lord saw